Hello students, I am Dr. Richa Bhatia from the Department of Commerce, the Bhopal School of Social Sciences. And today I'm here to discuss about a topic of advanced accounting, which is government accounting. Now before starting government accounting, let us first revise that what was accounting? Accounting is an art of recording, classifying and summarizing all the transactions which are financial in nature and interpreting the results thereof. We all know that commercial accounting or financial accounting is required to ascertain the profit and loss and the financial position of a particular business concern. Now, what do you mean by government accounting? As you can see that there are two words involved in the entire thing, that is government as well as accounting. So, government accounting refers to the process of recording and management of all the financial transactions that are incurred by the government, that includes its incomes and expenditures. The first main function of government accounting is the determination of the fidelity. Fidelity means the trust and the loyalty of the officers who are dealing with the funds of the government. And the second one is to see that whether the information which is being furnished, all the financial information which is being furnished, is according to the policy determination and administrative purposes. So these are the two main functions of government accounting. Now it's very important to differentiate that what is the difference between commercial accounting and what is the difference between the government accounting. Now we are going to discuss the differentiation one by one. So let us first start. Meaning, we all know that government accounting is mainly prepared by the government to know the income and expenditures of the government. And commercial accounting is to determine the profit and loss of any commercial concern. Objective. The main objective of government accounting is to see that whether the income and expenditure is according to the budget that has been proposed by the government. And for the commercial accounting, it is mainly prepared to know the financial position of the business and also to determine the profit and loss of that particular concern. Budget. We all know that when you're talking about government accounting, whatever accounts and statements are prepared, whatever disbursements are done by the government should be in accordance with the budget that is proposed by the government. But when you talk about commercial accounting and when we prepare the profit and loss account and the balance sheet, it is not at all related with the budget. We are just considering the sales and the revenues of that particular concern and deciding that what is the net profit and what is the financial position of that particular business concern. Moving on, the next one is cash basis. We all know that commercial accounting can be prepared on cash as well as on the credit basis. But when you talk about government accounting, we have to remember that it is prepared only and only on cash basis and not on credit basis. Then the level of accounting. The government accounting level is central, that is, it is prepared for the state government and the union government. But when you talk about the commercial accounting, the level is not central. It is prepared by each and every proprietor or each and every commercial unit according to their own requirements. Then you talk about the basis of accounts. You all know very well that when you talk about commercial accounting, there were three accounts: real, personal and nominal, and accordingly we had rules for journalizing, ledger and then preparation of the financial statements. But when you talk about government accounting, it is divided into three. The first one is the consolidated funds, the second one is the contingency funds, and the third one is the public accounts. These are the three accounts that have to be prepared for government accounting. I repeat, the first one is the consolidated funds, the second one is the contingency funds, and the third one is the public accounts. Now, audit report. We all know that whatever audit is done of a commercial unit, it has to be submitted to the proprietor. But when you talk about a government organization, the auditing is done by the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India, and that report has to be submitted to the President of India. And the last point is cost accounts. We all know that when you are talking about commercial accounting, cost accounting is also a part of it and it is prepared in some of the concerns. But when you talk about government accounting, cost accounting has no place in it. So that is the basic difference between the government accounting and the commercial accounting. Now let's start discussing the three accounts of government accounting one after another. According to the Indian Constitution, there are following accounts that have to be prepared for government accounting. The first one is the Consolidated Funds of India. The second one will be the Contingency Fund of India. And the third one will be the public accounts. Now, what are the items that will come in each of accounts? Let us discuss it one after another. Now, the first one is the Consolidated Funds of India. The union government and each state government has to prepare a separate fund, which is termed as Consolidated Fund of India or Consolidated Fund of that particular state. Now, what it includes? The first one, it includes all revenues received by the Government of India. Second, all loans raised by the Government of India by issue of treasury bills. Third, money obtained by means of ways and means of advances. And the fourth one is all money received in the repayment of loans that were previously made out from the Consolidated Funds of India. Now, when you talk about the Consolidated Fund of India, it will have three bifurcations. The first one is the revenue. In the revenue, we are going to discuss the revenues and the expenditures of the government. The second one is the capital account. In the capital account, we are going to discuss the capital receipts and the capital disbursements of the government. And the third one is the public debt. In the public debt, we are going to discuss the loans, advances, and the debts of the government. Now, let us start discussing the revenues and the expenditure. Now, when you talk about the revenues and the expenditure of the government, let us first discuss the revenue. Now, revenue in very simple terms means the receipts. Now, the receipts of the government can be of two types. It can be tax revenue, that is the income which is earned by the way of taxes. And the second one can be the non-tax revenue. Non-tax revenue is the income which is apart from taxes. Now, when you talk about the tax revenue, now tax revenue can be from incomes and expenditures, like you all know income tax is there. Taxes on property and capital transactions are also there, like capital gain tax. And the third one is the taxes on commodities and services, like we have GST. So all these are the receipts of the government. They are the tax receipts of the government. Now, when you talk about the non-tax revenue of the government, then that is apart from taxes. Apart from taxes, we can have interest, we can have dividends, we can have fines, we can have penalties that the government is taking from the citizens of the country. So when you talk about revenue, we have to remember that either it can be a tax revenue for the government or it can be a non-tax revenue for the government. Now, expenditures. Expenditures means that how much the government is incurring or spending on the country and on the citizens of the nation. So now when you talk about expenditures, it is divided mainly into four. The first one is the general services. The second one is the social services. The third one is the economic services. And the last one is the grants and the contributions and the subsidies that are given by the government. Now when you talk about general services, general services are also divided into some parts. Now, what are the main services? The first one can be defense. The second is the administrative services. Then we come to the servicing of debt. And the last one is the fiscal services. All these services are monitored and controlled by the government, for which it requires funds. Now, whatever funds the government is getting from the tax revenues and the non-tax revenues are spended on these particular services. So now we talk about consolidated fund, and in consolidated fund, the revenues and expenditures was the first part. Now let us talk about that what was the second part. The second part was the capital receipts and disbursements. Now capital receipts and disbursements of the government is mainly for agriculture and irrigation. So whatever receipts the government is getting and whatever disbursements the government is doing, basically on agriculture and irrigation, that comes in capital receipts and disbursements. The third part of the Consolidated Fund of India is the debt, loans and advances. Now this will include all the borrowings by the government and its repayment, and it will also include all the loans and advances that are paid by the government to the citizens and their recoveries. So consolidated fund will be basically three. The first one will be your revenues and expenditures. The second one will be your capital receipts and disbursements. And the third one will be your debts, loans and advances. This was the first part of the government accounting. Now let us discuss the second part of the government accounting, and that is what? Contingency fund. Now every union and state government has to prepare a contingency fund. Now contingency fund, as the name is suggesting, that it is for an unforeseen situation that is suffered by the nation or by the state. For that, every government has to create a fund, and that forms the part of government accounting which is termed as the contingency fund. Each of such funds is financed from time to time by such funds which are determined by the act of appropriate legislature or establishing the fund. Each of this fund is financed from time to time by such sums as may be determined by the act of the appropriate legislature which is establishing such a fund. Now, when you discuss about the third part of the government accounting, it is the public accounts. Now, public accounts will have all the money that the government is collecting from the public in the form of public provident fund, in the form of general provident fund, all these funds that have to be repaid by the government to the citizens on their retirement or on the situations that is mentioned will be included in the public accounts. Now these three, that is the consolidated funds of India, the contingency funds and the public accounts, in total will form the statements of government accounting. Now as you can see that there is a chart on the slide which is giving you a perfect bifurcation, and I will go through this chart once again. You can see that on the topmost it's the government accounts. The government accounts is divided into three: consolidated funds, contingency funds and public accounts. Consolidated funds, as we have already discussed, is divided into three parts: revenue accounts, capital accounts and public debt. In revenue accounts, we discussed the revenues and the expenditures. The revenues were tax and non-tax, and the expenditures were general expenditures, social expenditures, economic expenditures by the government. Capital accounts had the capital receipts and the capital borrowings, and the public debts had all the borrowings by the government as well as the loans and advances that were given to the government. The second part is the contingency fund. The contingency fund was a fund that is prepared for unforeseen expenditures. And the third one was the public accounts. In the public accounts, the government will keep a record of all the provident fund, statutory provident fund, public provident fund, general provident fund, the receipts as well as the disbursements. So these three together will form the government accounts. Now the last thing to discuss in government accounting is who audit it. So the auditing is done by the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India. Now the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India is appointed by the President of India, and he is appointed for a term of 6 years or 65 years, whichever is earlier. And his duties and powers are in accordance with the judge of the Supreme Court. So now let us discuss that what are the basic duties of the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India. The basic duties to audit. Now what all it has to audit, let us see one after the other. The first one, to audit and report the receipts and the expenditures of any department of union or state in respective consolidated funds. So whatever consolidated funds we have discussed, the revenues as well as expenditures, the duty to audit it of any state or any union territory will lie with the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India. Second, to audit all transactions of the union and the state in relation of contingency fund and public accounts. So whatever accounts were prepared by the state or the union territories in relation with contingency fund and public accounts, whatever receipts and disbursements have been done will be checked and audited by the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India. The third, to audit all the trading, manufacture and profit and loss account and balance sheet and subsidiary accounts which are kept by the government departments. So now whatever balance sheets and the records that the government department is keeping have to be checked and audited by the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India. The Comptroller and the Auditor General of India will also check the accounts of stores and stocks that are kept in the government organization, companies, as well as government cooperation. It will also check the authorities and the bodies that are substantially financed from the consolidated funds of the union and the state. Basically, it will see that whatever the funds are being taken from the consolidated fund of India by these authorities and bodies are being utilized for the purpose for which they have been sanctioned. Then, any body or authority, even though not substantially financed by the consolidated fund, but it will be audited by the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India on the request of the President or the Governor of India. And the last duty of Comptroller and Auditor General of India is to check and to see that all the grants and the subsidies which are given by the government for specific purposes are utilized for which they have been sanctioned. The Comptroller and the Auditor General of India will submit its report after auditing all the records to the President of India. So this was all about the basic and the theoretical concept of government accounting. Please refer to the chart and also to the formats of consolidated funds, contingency funds and public accounts which I have given in the presentation. I will see you again with more such interesting topics. Thank you.